Buonasera, signore, buonasera. Com'è bello stare a Napoli e sognare. Quante volte ho sussurrato amore, ti amo. Buonasera, signore, kiss me good night. Buonasera, signore, kiss me good night. Buonasera, Charles.
Buonasera, Lena. Buonasera. What, you know, it's just been a great month, a lot of energy going on, and it's a great day. Great day.
It is. It's very nice to see you today.
Likewise, you know, and there's just so much stuff. People are calling. We got a lot of good energy coming out the show. People from Texas reached out to me, and actually people up north in Louisiana reached out. So it's getting the word spreading, and we're getting a lot of great compliments. It's great.
That's fantastic. And we want to thank everyone for watching and giving us your support. We really appreciate it. And make sure you're watching WLAE on Sunday nights, 9 o'clock, celebrating culture with Charles Barsala. And then sometimes it's Buonasera, Louisiana.
Yes, we are finishing up what I call the Americana series, which, you know, growing up, my family would say, instead of American, they would say Americana.
Yeah. Yeah, American.
Yeah. We've done 24 episodes on Louisiana culture, and we're going to shift to a dozen episodes on the Sicilian migration into Louisiana. And intermixed with that is Buonasera. So it's working out really well right now.
That's fantastic. I'm looking forward to seeing those shows, Charles. And of course, you all can watch us on our YouTube channels, Lena Prima and Sicily Journal, and our Facebook page, Buonasera Louisiana. All right. So today, you know, we change our backgrounds because we're on Zoom. Zuma.
I'm going to call it Zuma.
Just so we have something interesting here, because otherwise my background is not pleasant.
And I think this is a great educational tool. Your background changes. This is our 10th episode. So you bring those cities of Italy. This is like a mini tour guide series that we're learning about Italy. I think your friend Stanley there, you know, I know he's doing Italy right now for CNN, but we're doing Italy for WLAE.
Exactly. And I'm learning a lot. It's really fun. And this I'm really excited about, because behind me today is Monteleone di Orvieto in Umbria. And of course I went, Monteleone, I play there. They earned a spot on the list of the most beautiful Italian towns by an Italian association aimed at preserving and promoting towns with fewer than 15,000 residents. And to be included on this list, the town has to demonstrate that they have the artistic, historical, and cultural heritage merit to the town. And they also have to take measures to protect the environment, offer tourist accommodations, and find ways to preserve local tradition. So this beautiful town, Monteleone di Orvieto, was added to the list thanks to its medieval walls, churches, and a castle that dominated the town in the 1300s. And many of the old houses in Orvieto are built above caves created from the excavation of materials to build the home. During World War II, these became shelters for safety, which I thought you would love that part, Charles.
Yeah, I do. So actually, I'm thinking the caves became wine cellars. Where do we get to that part?
I don't know about that part. Maybe they did become, I don't know. Anyway, I thought it was quite a beautiful place.
It is fabulous. What a great region right there. And then, you know, and it used to be that the Kingdom of the Two Sicilies went up to Naples. So Umbria is not that far north of the Kingdom of the Two Sicilies. It's a great region. It's not too far from Rome and between Florence. So it's a great place to see on a trip.
So that's my background today, Charles. Let's talk about yours, because you're floating in space.
So we Italians have a tremendous connection to Earth Day and taking care of the environment. So to start with, I want to tell you the amazing story is, I remember when I was 11 years old, Earth Day was having its first anniversary. It got started in 1970. 1970 rolls around and this commercial comes out, which is one of the top 50 commercials of all time. It's the crying Indian. And most people remember it. It's an Indian paddling a canoe and people are littering. And back in that time, it was very common for people to just throw their fast food stuff out the car window. It was amazing how America was disintegrating. So they have this deal, and they show this Indian on the canoe, and at the end, you see him shed a tear. And it was an iconic thing, motivated me to do a lot of things. But the interesting thing was, as it turns out, Iron Eyes Cody is a Sicilian whose real name is Oscar De Corte. And when I heard that, I had to go out to Lafayette, because he's from he was born in Louisiana, outside of Lafayette.
Oh my gosh. That's it, Charles. Everything's got Italian roots.
Everything is Italian. You know, Sicily is like the center of the globe. You know, and it all comes from Sicily.
That is amazing that you're telling me about this right now, because that commercial affected me. I was just 7 at the time, but I thought that that Iron Eyes Cody looked like my dad, that he resembled my dad, those facial features. I related it to my own father, and I was so affected, and I got so into ecology, and I wanted to save the planet.
It inspired me a lot, but you know, I guess maybe I connected to him. Maybe we Sicilians always connect now to the Native Americans because of that. But you know what? It'd be great to show Iron Eyes Cody next to your dad, because I agree with you. They could be cousins. You know, you need to do some DNA on that.
Yeah. And you know what else is, my dad was called the Chief. That was his nickname. He was even presented with a beautiful headdress by the Lakota tribe and made an honorary chief. And I painted a wooden Indian for him one time and as a present. And it was like a thing. So he already had this Indian thing going on.
All right. So Selena, Iron Eyes Cody, Oscar De Corte, if you're ever in Lafayette, Louisiana, or near there, it's Guyan and Kaplan are the towns he was born and raised in. Is a great little part of Acadiana right there. And it's worth stopping and dining and getting a taste for the Italian history of Southwest Louisiana.
Wonderful. It's very interesting to know this, Charles. Thank you. All right. So we're going to go right into my check this out section. Today it's 10 eating and drinking rules that Italians live by, and the Italians feel that this is the best way to live.
Just a fabulous way to enjoy life, you know.
Absolutely. Eating. Absolutely. So that's my check this out. And now we're ready for what, Charles? Charles celebrates culture.
Obviously my favorite part of our show.
I love it too.
So this is a great part because it's our local people and is what their thoughts are. So in this one, you know, because it is Earth, you know, we're looking at the Earth and Earth Week and everything that goes on with taking care of the planet. We find that the roots go back to St. Francis of Assisi. St. Francis, you know, where everybody sees him with the doves around him. He talked to the wolf. He became the patron saint of taking care of not only wildlife, but the planet itself. And that he's been great inspiration for many people to do things to take care of our planet, which is right now, we all know we need to do a better job. I interviewed a minister, Bonnie Poirier, and she actually is a minister, not Catholic, she's non-denominational, but she actually works with people who are grieving over the loss of a pet. I'm
I'm here today with Minister Bonnie Poirier. Mm-hmm. Her ministry is the Ministry of St. Francis of Assisi.
Yes.
And Bonnie, St. Francis of Assisi is actually who the Pope took his name from. Tell us about how that happened.
I gotta tell you, that was probably a miracle. Pope Francis taking St. Francis of Assisi's name is more than that. He is living as Jesus lived, because St. Francis of Assisi lived as Jesus lived. We have this Pope who was bringing all of these people back to church. He is bringing people to an awareness that all life is sacred. And the fact that he has done this is opening up so many people to so many possibilities in honoring, respecting, and caring for God's creation. One of the things that I truly appreciate about St. Francis of Assisi is that he lived as Jesus lived. There were no big ornaments around him, no fancy clothing were on his body. But when it came to animals, this wolf was originally terrorizing this village, and the people were terrified of this wolf. They really wanted the wolf to die because they were terrified. But they went to Francis, and Francis went off with this wolf, started talking with this wolf, and come to find out, he realized this wolf was hungry. So he went back to the village and said, you know what, I think if you left some food for him, that we could all have a more peaceful kingdom here. And they did. And the wolf and the people lived together peacefully. The Bible has so many indicators of how we are to live with animals. For instance, in 2 Samuel, we have where Nathan is talking to David about a rich man and a poor man, and this poor man and how he cared for this one little ewe lamb that's all he had in this world. And it drank from his cup and ate from his plate and slept in his arms, and he treated this lamb as a daughter. This lamb grew up with his children. That's in the Bible. And when we have the ark, God could have told him, hey, you know what? We're going to have a big flood. We're going to destroy everything that's on the face of this earth. Let's gather our architects and our engineers and our plumbers to get things going again. No, he gathered up the animals two by two.
I want to thank you, Bonnie, for being a guest on our show. It's always wonderful in working with you in the community and seeing what you've done for people who are grieving for their pets, and your vision about how we should interact, and just the ministry is just a great thing that you've done for New Orleans.
Thank you.
We'll be right back.
So there actually are 3 acres set aside in Metairie Cemetery, which is where I interviewed her, about St. Francis, and also leading into Pope Francis. Because Pope Francis picked the name St. Francis because he thought we needed to pay more attention to the planet. And he's the first pope to ever pick Francis as his name. He issued Laudato Si about 7 years ago. Laudato Si is his calling that we need to have a dialogue of the countries of the planet, need to have a dialogue about taking better care of the planet. So we have all these agrotoxins that go into our waters. We have all these other issues. And Pope Francis said this is what he wanted his papacy to be about. So that's a great job that he's doing. In fact, Lena, one time they actually had an hour display on the Vatican at Christmas time showing endangered species, elephants and tigers and lions. It was beautifully done for about an hour of these great shots of these animals. So he's been a great job of bringing attention to this. And then in line with that. Yes, it is great. And then I interviewed Frank Maselli, and who is our consul, and I interviewed him about what it's like for the Italians and our individual and how we care about animals and how we're taught respect for animals. So Frank gave us a great interview on and a few great words of advice and wisdom on how to care for our animals in Italian style.
I think love of the earth, all of God's creatures, I think that's just a very integral part of the Italian culture and, you know, spirituality. Well, obviously St. Francis dedicated his life toward respecting the earth and all of the animals on the earth. And in light of that, I can remember many, many years ago, my 90-year-old grandmother, every time we'd eat the big pasta lunch, she'd gather all the breadcrumbs in the tablecloth and go out and feed the birds. And it was a scene right out of St. Francis, all the birds flying in. It was a wonderful thing. The Italians are just, I think, humble people. I mean, we're very respectful. We're very respectful of our religion, of our family, of the earth, of the animals. We don't waste. We're just respectful people. You know, as a little boy, I loved elephants, to be honest. I wanted to be an elephant trainer when I was 7 years old. I was into animals. I loved animals. I still do. Still love animals. One thing in Italy, this is what I learned, that when you sit down at a meal, everyone eats everything on their plate. Now, I've been to 12-course meals, two 12-course meals within like 14 hours. They don't waste. So you never see them like, oh, you know, throwing away half a plate of food. So they see, it's that respect. They respect the food. They respect everything. And they treat the animals really well. You know, animals are welcome anywhere in Italy, in the restaurants, everywhere. They really treat the animals well. You can go to a restaurant, nice restaurant, the dogs are sitting right there, and they feed the dogs right there. Nobody says anything.
Frank, thank you for being on the show. That was wonderful. Our New Orleans Insider Tour app features a Statue, Stories, and Spirits tour. There are over 150 markers that all have a little story. Download our tour to make your stay in New Orleans extra special.
That was a great interview, Charles. I love hearing Frank Maselli talk about that. And also, really great interview with Minister Bonnie, which I learned all about her. I didn't know anything about her. So I think it's wonderful that you interviewed her, and what she's doing is terrific.
It really is. And St. Francis, I just learned so much from learning about him and what he was about. And you know, what inspired him, the first nativity scenes were actually living nativity scenes that were done. And then later we have these figures and that became out where people, you could buy it, and it's evolved to where it is today. But the first nativity scenes were actually done in his same neighborhood in Italy. And what a great thought to know that that's where it got started, in around 1226 AD.
God, yeah, that is really, really cool. I didn't know that either. Charles always teaching us stuff.
Yes, it's great. It's also, you know, it's amazing what our history is. And obviously Italy has so much history, and the Sicilian migration in New Orleans. We just have a lot to be grateful for.
We really do, Charles. And thank you very much for your segment today. I love it. All right, it's time for La Musica today. And Charles, we've been talking a lot about young Italian Americans carrying on our heritage and our traditions and the ideals of family and community. And I met this wonderful young man and would love to highlight him today and his family. His name is Vincent Innocente. And I call him my cousin Vinny on Staten Island. And he's not only a singer and a piano player, but also the marketing manager of the historic St. George Theater on Staten Island, which was built in 1929. It's just incredibly beautiful. It reminds me a lot of the Sanger Theater, all the beauty inside and the architecture inside. And so it's great that he's involved with that theater and their ongoing restoration. And his grandmother sang in church choir and had a little singing group in the 1950s called the Three Dimensions. His mom is a choir instructor and a music teacher and plays organ at St. Rock Church on Staten Island every Sunday. His mom taught him to play piano at age 4, and he's been playing his whole life. He also grew up singing in choirs and at church, and he now plays solo at clubs and cocktail hours, and he has a band that just celebrated 10 years together called Cause and the Effects, and they are a wedding, festival, private event type group. He's also played with the Drifters, the Coasters, and Bobby Wilson, and his family heritage on his mother's side is Naples and Palermo, and his dad's mother is from Naples but moved to Switzerland to work. So his dad was actually born in Switzerland, and they moved to New York in the early 70s. He's really proud of his Italian heritage.
Well, that is great. I mean, I love, you know, in the Swiss, that borderline right there between Switzerland and Italy. I mean, you don't know which side you're on, really. So if his dad was born in Switzerland, the Italian Alps are so close by, and the Italian towns, I'm sure there's a huge influence of Italian culture in that part of Switzerland also.
Oh, yeah, that's interesting to know.
Yeah.
So he's a big fan of my dad, and that's how we actually met each other. He wrote a letter to my dad when he was 12 asking for his autograph without knowing that my dad had passed away. So my mother wrote him back saying that my father had gone to heaven, and she sent him a collection of my dad's CDs. So now later, Vincent's coming to New Orleans for a visit, and he writes to me through my website wanting to know some places my father might have gone or where he could see some historic things. So I wrote him back and said all these places he could go, and then, hey, how about we meet at Bricadas? Because my father loved Bricadas so much. So we met there and we had some gelato, and then we actually went together to where my father is buried at Metairie Cemetery and visited his grave and just became friends. And then we got to perform together at the Columbus Day Parade in New York the last time I was there. And He's just a wonderful young man and talented and loves his family. He's just a great example of what we've been talking about, Charles.
That is great. And Lena, I'm clicking some dots here together because, I mean, your dad seemingly, his music was dance music. When you think of dancing, you think of teenagers. So like the fact that we see this connection, it's pretty neat that we need to let that out there more, I believe, where your dad's music becomes a way of getting the younger generation of Italians back into the culture and heritage. Because he slips in all these stories. And somebody sent me something recently, seeing our show, about bananas, a banana market, saying, Charles, you and Lena would probably really appreciate this. Because you're talking about...
Yeah, you're exactly right, Charles. In fact, Vincent said to me that music connects his family in a special way. And he loves their music, and it bridges the gap in the generations. And that's why music is so important to him and his family.
That's fabulous.
Yeah, so I put together a little video montage so you can meet Vin Innocente and his family. I hope you enjoy it. If you get to Staten Island, you got to look him up. That's all I have to say. He's wonderful and his family is wonderful. So if you'd like to know more about Vin Innocente, the website for his band is causeandtheeffects.com. You can follow them on Facebook, Cause and the Effects, and you can follow Vin on Instagram, Real Vin Nocente. Vinocente.
I like that.
And at Cause and the Effects as well. Thank you so much. Grazie, Vincent. Cousin Thank Vinny. You, Vincent.
Staten Island, here we come.
Yeah. Yeah, there's actually a great restaurant on Staten Island called Nona's. Nona's of the world.
Grandma's. The grandma's cooking. And also, one that we just did pizzas, the best pizza. Is there a pizza place in Staten Island we need to do as well?
I'm going to say yes, Charles. We'll call Vinny.
Yeah, we definitely. Pizza with Vinny.
Yes. So I really enjoyed the show today. I learned a lot again.
As did I, Lena. You got me thinking Umbria, Staten Island, Vinny, pizza.
And ecology. We're ecologists. We're ecologists, yeah, at heart.
We got to think about, this is a great time to be thinking about Italians and how we want to care for the planet. And, you know, also how to eat. The 10 things you listed about how to eat.
Thank you so much for watching, everyone. We really appreciate it.
Ciao. Ciao.
Quante volte ho sussurrato amore, ti amo. Buonasera, signore, kiss me goodnight.
I am Lena Prima. My music is available on Amazon and iTunes. I would love it if you would subscribe to my YouTube channel, Lena Prima. Thank you so much. Ciao.